Survival is everything.
Nothing can survive here.
Dan and I worked with John Bradley for 8 seasons of Game of Thrones and loved every minute of it.
And he never died.
But we never got to kill him.
No.
And so we had
something missing from our lives.
I'm Francis Bacon.
I was intrigued because they said to me, we're going to write a character for you that's more like yourself than any character you've ever played.
The game found something we're both familiar with.
You better not have gone through my search history.
In amongst all the bluster and in amongst all the humor and the wisecracking, there's a really beautiful soul in there who really wants to take care of his friends.
Both of us thought, God, it'd be really fun to have a character who is not Samwell, but more like the John Bradley that we're watching right
and
now.
And John's just so effortlessly confident and quick and witty.
You do you, and I'll be in the pub when you come to your senses.
No, Rooney.
The Santee want compliance.
You said I was free to go.
You were?
But Jack's just too much of a strong personality, so he falls foul of them.
All you had to do was keep playing.
In our original conception, the Tatiana character didn't really have that many scenes.
No.
Marlo, you know, she's such a great actress to watch.
She ended up being in, I think, almost all of the episodes, and in crucial moments of almost all the episodes. So that's a credit to her as an actor.
The answers to all of your questions are waiting for you in level 4.
Much of the episode regarding the headset and the video game is this mind-bendy experience of, like, what is this all about?
We don't have this technology. Where did this come from?
Why are we experiencing all these crazy things?
The stars, Augie's countdown, this video game, they're all virtual realities indistinguishable from actual reality.
Through the Oppenheimer's Mistress example, you're meant to wonder, how did this happen to this guy, and are things what they seem?
Oppenheimer's Mistress died the same way, on her knees and in a tub.
When we first shot the scene, I thought, how many people are gonna know this reference? And now, thanks to Christopher Nolan, you know, it's
a very big, very well-made explanation of this moment.
The discovery of this body at the beginning of episode 3 leads to Dashi finding the headset for the first time.
Oh, hello, darling.
One of my favorite shots in the episode is Wade looking at the headset. Every single time you see the headset on screen, VFX department had to digitally replace the actual reflections with the reflections we wanted people to see.
They create their simple shots visually, but they're not simple on a visual effects level. Like every single one of them, you need a 360-degree picture of the entire room you're sitting in, and it needs to be painstakingly mapped onto this object to create the mirrored image that you're seeing.
What's engineering got to say about this?
No, look, getting it to work, but they did identify some very interesting components.
So now, the folks in the Black Palace have their hands on this, though they can't make head or tail of it yet. But we dive even deeper into the weirdness.
It's got a retinal scanner, an oxygen meter, and a brainwave sensor.
So while you're playing the game, someone at the other end is playing you.
Level 3.
One of the most visually memorable moments from the book of, you know, 30 million people all being sucked up into the sun.
I think when we all read these books, it's like, well, this is different. There's no doubt about that.
To see the work that the VFX team did, the Kublai Khan Pleasure Dome sequence has so much visually.
It's such a fun idea, and just the mixing of that grounded historical reality with something that's completely bonkers.
We took full advantage of reality with that world. We were able to build the very tip observation deck that would be on the top of the dome, and then imply the rest of the world.
One of the fun things about doing those video game sequences is that there's no limit to how weird they can get. You know, also a chance to work with, you know, some of our favorite comedic actors, which was Lee Shearsmith and Mark Gatiss.
I've developed a science I call calculus.
Action.
Andrew Stanton was the one director that we had spoken to who was not scared of the game sequences.
I love it.
Brush off a little faster.
Just given his history at Pixar, he knew exactly what to do, or at least he convinced us he knew exactly what to do, and he did.
Civilization number 184 was destroyed.
I don't know if we had an idea of what, at least in those scenes with Evans talking to the Lord, mm-hmm. what would be on the other end.
Where was I?
Until after we cast C and heard her voice, and it was so perfect.
You said the boy Hansel was afraid, but the girl was not?
Not at the moment, no.
It does sound a little bit AI generated.
I really wanted her to sound grounded, humanistic, and powerful without having to be loud.
She doesn't really go full robot, but she does something that just sucks all the emotion out of her voice, which is a funny thing for C to do, since she seems completely incapable of doing that in her real life. She's a very warm, one of the warmest people in the world.
The moment we received the invitation to your world, we knew our destination.
Watching Sword Lady and cute little girl's explanation of what's really going on to Jin and Jack, and watching how Eve Ridley as follower goes from cute to really menacing, but also cute at the same time.
We can't wait to meet you.
There's a lot happening in that scene, and almost all of it pays forward into the rest of the show.
They're real. We call them the Santi.
Come on, this is mental. She's talking about aliens.
This is the first time, I think, that we use the word aliens. So, you know, for this show that is about aliens, so we go almost to the end of episode 3 before that's even put on the board, and hopefully you get the feeling of like, oh, of course.
We built an interstellar fleet of 1,000 ships. And they are on their way.